Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Good to be here again. You know, if you can find one of these little books, the same songs are in a lot of them. But we're going to sing out this one this morning just so you can get used to it. Oh, see our new drummer? Give him a hand. That's Connor. We love Connor, and Connor loves everybody, I guarantee you. Now, page 32, and you probably don't even need the book. Standing on the promises, and you can't sing it sitting down. Number 32. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of mountain fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Keep singing. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord. Bound to him eternally by love's strong cord. Overcoming daily by the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Keep singing. One more verse. Standing on the promises I cannot. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. My Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing. I have everything I need to make me happy. I have Jesus to show me the way. Have Jesus to show me the way. He has saved me. He has saved me. And he gave me life eternal. Now I have everything. Sing it again. You're learning it, okay? I have everything I need to make me happy. I have Jesus. Show me the way. Have Jesus to show me the way. He has saved me. He has saved gave me life eternal. Now I have everything. And now I have everything. Please remain standing for prayer.
Good morning, everybody. How many of you are standing? How many of you are standing on the promises? I've decided whether I'm standing and they knock me down, I'm still standing or laying on the promises. I'm not going nowhere. I'm in for the long haul. Haven't we had a wonderful time? What's today? Tuesday? Boy, you lose track of everything when you're having a good time. Anyway, I just want to take a moment to thank all the workers and the cooks and all the bus boys, those little kids that come around. They take your tray and they're so polite, but they don't leave. They come over and they get your tray.
Thank you.
It's obvious. And I said, who tells you to do this?
My mother.
Anyway, thank God for his goodness. Glad to have Todd Watson with us. He is going to preach. He's a local pastor in Columbus, and he has filled in for us many times. Yeah, he lives in Columbus and pastors in Springfield, about a half hour up the road. But anyway, he's like a real soft rain. And he is so pleasant. He's palatable. And that rain just keeps soaking and soaking and soaking. He preached for us just before the camp meeting came. He had a fabulous service. And we thank God for all our ministers, young ministers that are coming up doing a great job. They all do a great job. Todd has a little different style. And I hope that you'll enjoy him this morning. But anyway, want to go to the Lord in prayer. Jack Emery, I don't see him yet. He fell down the stairs. He broke his arm, had some other issue going on. His wife wasn't feeling well. Danny Lane got out of the hospital, so we thank God for that. Sister Lewis, one of our members in the congregation, she's got leukemia. She's got an aggressive kind. And they had a bone marrow biopsy, so we're waiting to hear the results. But she has been improving, and there's some kind of pill that they can give you now instead of the bone marrow treatment. And at this moment, the pill is working. So we're just praying that she'll be able to recover. Want to pray for everybody that's heading this way, safe travel. And then we want to pray for our services today. Thank God for, like I said, Brother Todd. And then we did a flip. Rick Webb is, Rick, are you here? Rick is preaching. We connected, right? Rick Webb. You know, I have to take a Valium every time we do the minister's schedules. High stress. You ever try to coordinate 15 ministers? And, you know, when they're coming, last minute, you know, this, that, and the other thing. But it all seems to just come out in the end just the way God wants it. So Rick's going to be preaching tonight, and Brother Watson's going to be preaching this morning. I'll take your burden by an upraised hand. Here's an announcement. Please, on behalf of the kitchen staff, please do not put your gum on the plastic trays. We have people like that in this church? Really? Have you checked, you know, when you sit down and pull your chair up, get a little sticky sometimes? Oh. All right, so I don't know who the gum chewers are, But you've just been indicted. All right. Come on up, brother. What a jewel. This Brother Freeman from Tennessee, and they come 1,000 miles one way, and he's one of the regulars that comes to our camp meeting. He's a dear brother in the Lord. Amen. And let me tell you something. He's always happy and he's always smiling. And he's always got, what, 8 or 9 kids with him, right?
Yeah. The list is
so sad. It is a miracle.
It is. Thank you, Brother Tony. I want to say to the congregation, appreciate y'all praying for us. You haven't seen us. It's been 7 years since I've been here. My wife cooks for the state camp meeting where we go. And that's why we're going to get here. And all the dates been clashing. I'm trying to get Brother Tony to change them where we could come. It used to be when y'all was in it, we could come right on up. But now they ride along with us when we're in camp here. So she's a state cook. So if she cooks, that means I got to be there. So that's why we all haven't seen us all this time. I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you, O God, for this gathering. We thank you for Brother Tony. We ask, Lord, you remember all the upraised hands, and particularly those that are on the sick list. May you give them a man, Lord, the sister with leukemia. We know you're still a miracle-working God. Amaze the doctors, Lord. Do what they say can be done. And bless those that are on the highway, that are traveling. Lord, we almost had a mishap, but we're thankful for the angels. Lord, keep the drivers alert wherever they have to come from. And help those that live, as the brother said the other night, to trust you by faith. Not let the McCormick 19 dictate our lives, Lord. Bless today. Bless the service. Bless the speaker. Brother Todd, oh God, give the anointing from heaven. Amen. That we'll be able to say amen to your will. And the saints will be the better for it. And we'll thank you even now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
May we see it.
We'll take an offering this morning and we'll praise the Lord while we do it. Number 89. Number 89. Same little book. Sorry. Little book.
We will be taking an offering for missions and to help defray some of the costs of the meeting on Thursday. It'll give you time to think about it, whatever the Lord lays on your heart. Also, if anybody's here that didn't hear the messages yesterday for the ladies' luncheon and you would like to go, it is today. And you can meet with Sister Crouch at the end of the church. I don't know when they're leaving, but ask any of the sisters, find out who's going. I think they're going to leave around 11:45 or something like that. It's going to be at the Buxton Inn.
This is a song you can really get into. We'll praise the Lord for sins forgiven, praise Him evermore, till earth has passed away forever, Christ we will adore. We'll tell the story and give God glory, for He has saved us by His blood, and we will sing and praise the Lord. When like a scroll the sky has vanished, still we'll praise the Lord. We'll praise the Lord for full salvation, hearts made pure and free. We'll praise Him for a blessed infilling and for victory. Oh, we'll tell the story and give God glory, for He has saved us by His blood, and we will sing and praise the Lord when life the sky has vanished. Still we'll keep going. Great song. We'll praise Him for a church drive. How about it? Where every soul is made in Jesus, whiter than the snow. We'll tell the story and give God glory, for He has One more verse.
We'll praise the Lord, for this dark valley is no longer drear. The light of love dispels the shadow, drives away our tears. We'll tell the story and give God glory. Saved us by his blood, and we will sing and praise the Lord when, like a scroll, the sky has vanished. Still, we'll
sing a chorus one more time.
We'll tell the story and give God glory, for he has saved us. When, like a scroll, the sky has vanished, still we'll praise the Lord.
We're going to sing it one more time. You remember the message last night? Because he did not give God glory, the wheels came off. Everything was wrong. I'm going to see if you can sing it. And put your hand up and we'll give God. Yeah, that's not necessary, but it sure helps the song leader. Chorus, before I get myself in trouble.
We'll tell the story and give God glory, for he has saved us by his blood, and we will sing and praise the Lord when, like a scroll, the sky has vanished. Still, we'll praise the Lord.
Amen. Brother Clark has a song. He can sing too. Yes.
Okay. It says we'll tell the story, so I'm going to tell you my story. First 6 months of last year, I had 3 joint replacements due to taking chemotherapy. I had cancer, and it was stage 3, and I took a lot of chemotherapy, and it destroyed my joints. And so in the first 6 months of last year, I had 3 joint replacements. First 2 went great, and everything was good. And the third one after, I had it. I don't know how, and they don't know how, but somehow tore the muscle in my new hip. Tore away from the titanium part. I really don't understand everything. But in December of last year, I had an MRI, and the doctor assured me that there was absolutely no way it could heal itself, because metal and muscle don't mend together. And I just went home so devastated, because I thought, Lord, I just cannot go through another heavy-duty surgery like that. And I couldn't lift my leg. I couldn't lift it off the floor. I would look at it and I would will it to come up an inch. It would not. My husband had to lift my leg into the car. He had to lift my leg into bed. He had to help me get dressed. It was a lot of things. And in February, we took a victory lap for being retired and ended up down in Louisiana at Sister Sarah's congregation. And I just mentioned to her, told her that, you know, I was going to have another surgery, and you know how I felt so discouraged, and she just anointed me and prayed for me, and I never even tried to lift my leg after that. I don't know why. I guess I thought because the doctor said it couldn't heal itself, it wasn't going to heal itself. And in March, I was laying in the recliner. We got home in March, and I was laying back in the recliner, and I was fully tilted, and the Lord spoke to me. He said, lift your leg. And I just thought, well, what? Are you kidding me? And so I lay there for a couple more minutes, and the Lord said, lift your leg. And I lifted that leg straight up off of there. I can lift it today. I can move it. I can get in and out of the car. He doesn't have to help me anymore. I can walk without a limp. It's my story, and I want to tell him thanks for everything.
Amen. Amen. Not only that, when she had these surgeries. You know, you miss work, you miss time, you miss everything. She got her surgery when?
On Wednesday.
Wednesday? She was on the piano bench on Sunday.
All three surgeries.
All three times. Dedication, no wonder God healed her. Brother Clark, come on.
I'm so thankful to be here today. Since I was here last time I was here, I weighed 135 pounds. I almost died twice. And the doctors tell me I've had three strokes. But thank God he's on the throne today. And I'm just thankful that I know this living Savior. Thank you for many of you that have prayed for me. And it's a joy to be here. And I love this song. I hope I can sing it. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when seed the song, I'll get it right. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well. Thought my sin not in part but the whole is nailed to the cross and I bear it no more. Even so it is well. Sherm, the words in this book is very small, but I thank the Lord for it anyway. Okay. And Lord, haste the day when my face shall be sigh, the clouds be rolled back is a scroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. Help me out, okay? It is well with my soul. It is well,
That's called singing from the heart. Amen. We have a youth trio to come and sing. There they are. Look at all these kids. They need a hand.
This morning, your presence filled the room. With a grateful heart, I just shook my head as I bowed in awe of you. Lord, you have been so faithful, so loving, kind, and true. And every morning, your mercies are new. Good, more than I could ever dream you would. You have been good. You have been good, immeasurably more than you should. You have been good. Done for me, and my mind cannot grasp the depths of your generosities, the riches of your mercies, the wonders of your ways. And my voice cries out in endless praise. You have been good. You have been good, more than I could ever dream you would. You have been good. You have been good, immeasurably more than you should. You have been good.
No matter what the future holds or what tomorrow brings,
you are sovereign God of the universe. You are Lord of everything. You are still good. You are still good,
more than I could ever dream you would.
You are still
good.
You are still
good, immeasurably more than you should. You have been
good. Let's pray for Brother Watson now as he comes to share with us what the Lord has laid on his heart. He's one cool dude.
Love you, sir. Thank you. Well, praise the Lord, everybody. It's so good to be here in the house of the Lord one more time. And it is a delight to be here for camp meeting. We thank God for technology, which affords us the opportunity to while we may be absent one from another physically, we're still able to, because of the technology, to be a part of the camp meeting digitally. And so I've not watched all of the services yet. I've heard the meeting thus far has just been a tremendous blessing. But I am looking forward to binging several episodes of Camp Meeting 2020 when I get back home and after I leave work tonight from my secular employer. And by God's grace, we'll be back to fellowship and worship and experience the word on Thursday and Friday and possibly even Saturday evenings as well. But thank God for this wonderful pastor and first lady, under shepherd, who God has so graciously blessed to be able to lead and guide such a wonderful congregation. The saints here at Licking County, and even some of the saints that I've met through camp meeting, who I'm seeing again, faces that I'm seeing again, haven't seen in a while. Just so good to be in the house of the Lord with the people of the Lord. I don't think there is a better place to be than to be in the house of the Lord, worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth with the saints, with the people of God. I can't wait. Well, let's just say I'm not itching to up the date, but I can't wait till we get to do this forever in heaven. When all of God's children will be able to sit around the throne and sing and worship and interact and fellowship and just bless the name of the Lord all day. There'll be no night. We'll just be able to worship in spirit and in truth, and it's just going to be magnificent. Until then, I'll take camp meeting. I'll take camp meeting. And I want to thank you for saints, pastors. I want to thank you because you decided not to serve Dr. Fauci. That's not a Republican statement or a Democrat statement. I thank you because you decided not to serve CNN, Fox, MSNBC. I am grateful and thankful to be in the presence of pastors and leaders and saints who said we serve Jesus and we don't serve statistics. Come on, we got to clap for that. We serve Jesus. We don't serve man. We are the saints of the Most High God. And wherever the presence and the spirit of the Lord is, not only is there victory, but guess what? There's healing, there's deliverance, there's life, there's hope and health. And I thank God for your courage this morning. You had the courage to say, Dr. Fauci, I don't serve you. Doctors, we don't serve doctors. Did you hear that testimony? Listen, our God has the final say this morning. I could really sit down on that right there. Our God has the final say this morning, and it is not over until God says it's over. I want you to be encouraged by that this morning. I want you to be reminded by that. I pray that the Spirit of the Lord will keep that in your head and in your heart all week long. It is not over in my life until God says it's over. Whose report will you believe? I have determined that it is needed, it is necessary, it is important that we believe the report of the Lord. We respect our physicians. We respect our scientists. Did you know Luke was a physician? But we believe the report of the Lord because there is a physician who is the great physician who can heal us, who can deliver us, who can protect us, no matter what's happening in the culture, no matter what's happening in the society. Our Savior, our Lord, Jesus, our Christ, our Messiah, He has the final say.
So we thank God. I don't know about the gentle rain part. Some of y'all are saying, where's that gentle rain? But I'm challenged in my spirit this morning when preachers and when people of faith who talk about I'll go into the lion's den with the Lord. No, you won't. I'm disturbed in my spirit. I'm challenged. I'm a little vexed. I'm a little perplexed when saints will stand up. For God, I'll live, and for God, I'll die, and I'll go with him everywhere he leads me. Unless Dr. Fauci says so. I don't know about that gentle rain stuff. Some of y'all, I'm still waiting for the gentle rain. And one of the reasons why the world is so disturbed with the church is because we don't practice what we preach. Young people, I want to encourage you this morning. Stand for the Lord. Live for God. There's no greater service that you can serve than in the service of the Lord. Stand for him. Live for him. Die for him. And don't back down. Don't compromise. Don't walk away from the truth of God's word. Stand on it. He is Jehovah Jireh, our provider. And if he can do all that we say and believe and claim and preach that he's done through generations and times past in scripture, then he can help you with COVID. He can help you with your academics. Couples, he can help you in your relationship. Singles, he can help you with your singleness. Seniors, he can cause muscle to mend to metal. I don't care what the doctors say. Jesus says, I'm going to put muscle on metal. Tell the doctor to be quiet. I'm going to put muscle on metal. You will lift your leg if you trust in me and have faith and believe. The world sees us say one thing on Sunday morning at 10 or 11 o'clock. But they watch us when tragedy and when pandemic happens. They watch what we do. And so I'm hoping that you came to camp meeting with the desire to say, Lord, I want to come out stronger in my faith in camp meeting. That's what I love about camp meeting. It's just this time for the saints to come together, and we're revived and we leave rejuvenated to go back out into the world full of the love of Christ, full of the love of the Lord, ready to serve and to pray for and to care for a lost and dying world. But listen, saints, listen. Be encouraged this morning. There's going to be some challenges. There's going to be some trials. There's going to be some tests. But that's what the world needs to see. That these are people who practice what they preach. They're not going to let COVID. They're not going to let social distancing. They're not going to let doctors and doctors' reports keep them from gathering. Guess what? This is where the Lord gives us the strength and the courage to be the church. So I love camp meeting. So excited to be here. Because we leave from camp meeting better than when we arrive. I don't know about this gentle rain stuff. Still waiting for the gentle rain to fall on me this morning. We come to camp meeting with a question. All of us have come to camp meeting with this question. There is a particular question that not only in 2020 thus far, should the Lord tarry for the remainder of 2020? We've asked this question in 2020, but there are a whole host of us who have had to ask this question from time to time. There's a question. There's a question that we've come into this sanctuary with this morning. It's a question that our seasoned saints have had to ask. When racked with pain in their bodies, it's a question that middle-agers have had to ask when they are caught between their youth and the reality that there are probably more sunsets
behind them than they are in front of them. It's a question that young adults ask when they have had to deal with all of the temptation and all of the frustration that being that young adult experiences can have heaped and thrust upon them. We all have come with a question that even our little children have asked. One question. And we find that question in Psalm 13. Will you turn with me to Psalm 13 this morning? One question that all of us, it doesn't matter your socioeconomic status, it doesn't matter how many degrees that you may have, it doesn't matter if you just have a GED, you may not have even completed your academic pursuits, but all of us have had to ask this question for one time or another. It's a question that does not care about your racial makeup, your racial background, your ethnicity. It's a question that all of us have had to ask. This question cares not about your political affiliation. It is a question Republicans have asked. It is a question that Democrats have had to ask. It's a question even those who don't believe in God at all have asked. And David asks in Psalm 13. Here it is, starting at the first verse. O Lord, how long? O Lord, how long? How many of you, let's just take a formal survey really quickly, have found yourself at some stage, some place, some time in your life having asked the question, Lord, how long? Preachers have asked the question, how long? Pastors have had to ask the question, how long? Laypersons, lay leaders, those who serve in the spotlight ministries that everyone can see, like the choir, those who serve in ministries that barely are ever mentioned or noticed. O Lord, how long? And perhaps you have come to camp meeting like I have come to camp meeting, asking, Lord, how long? David asks, Psalm 13, O Lord, how long will you forget me? I'm reading. Did I mention that I'm reading from the New Living Translation? All right. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. O Lord, how long will you forget me? Someone has come to camp meeting this morning feeling forgotten. They may not say it. You may not see visible signs of it. They may never express it. But perhaps you are here this morning, or perhaps you are here and you have been interceding in prayer for someone who did not come to camp meeting this year, who feels forgotten. How have you ever felt forgotten? Have you ever felt overlooked? Have you ever felt like no one sees me? Here it is, and David asks, Lord, how long will you forget me? There are those seasons, there are those times, and if you came to camp meeting with that question, camp meeting is a great place to come with that question, because it does seem like, even as a believer, even as a man of faith, even as a woman of faith, there are times when those of us who hold on to faith feel as though God, where are you in this time in my life? Don't think it strange. Don't feel odd, young adults. Don't feel like you are the odd man or the odd woman out, teenager, if you have come to camp meeting asking, Lord, where are you in this season in my life, in this time of my life, in this place of my life? I cannot see you. I do not feel you. Lord, where are you? David asked the same question that perhaps many of us came to camp meeting with this morning. How long will you forget me? What a question. Oftentimes, people feel forgotten because of childhood experiences that they are still grappling with and wrestling with. Oftentimes, people feel forgotten because of problems that they're facing, that they're dealing with on their jobs, and they have asked God over and over and over again for help with this particular coworker or with this particular supervisor, and it just seems like instead of the problem getting better, it just seems like it's getting worse. How many of you have ever lived through experiences in your life where it seemed like the more you asked the Lord for help to make it better, it just got worse? David says, Lord, he asks, how long will you forget me? How long will you look the other way? Sometimes it seems as though there are points and places in our lives where God, instead of just looking on you, it seems as if he's just done this for you in your situation. What a tragic feeling, but what a very real feeling when it feels like God has just turned his back on your life. God, I prayed. God, I served. God, I witnessed. I worked. And here it is. I'm going through a cancerous situation. I'm going through, I'm starting to feel the effects, or the doctors told me that perhaps, or my family has told me that I'm starting to show signs of dementia. God, where are you? And it seems like the more you pray, the further and further he gets or goes away, and it seems like he's turned his back on you. How long? Then in the next verse, David asks again, how long must I struggle? How many have come to camp meeting? Don't raise your hand, but how many have come to camp meeting and you come to camp meeting with some struggles? Camp meeting is a great place to come if you're struggling. Camp meeting is a great place to come. Every service, you want to be in every service. If you feel forgotten this year, this is a great time to be in camp meeting. You want to be in every service if you feel forgotten. You want to be in every service that you possibly can. If you are here this morning and you feel like, Lord, I need your help in my struggle, where are you? How long am I going to have to struggle? There may be some couples here saying, Lord, how long am I going to have to struggle in my marriage? There may be some parents that are here saying, Lord, how long are we going to have to struggle with our children? Who we birthed or we adopted, we may not be their biological parents, but we have raised them. They are like our sons and our daughters, and we are watching Satan tear their lives to pieces. How long? There may be some of us who are here this morning who are struggling with depression and anxiety. And you've taken pill after pill. You've seen psychologists. You've seen psychiatrists. And the question is, how long am I going to have to struggle with these feelings of inadequacy? How long am I going to have to struggle, dear Lord, with these feelings of fear, with these feelings of just a loss of self-control. How long, Lord, am I going to have to? Perhaps there's somebody here and you have anger issues, and your question is, how long, Lord, am I going to have to struggle with my struggle? Here's the good news. Here's the good news. It doesn't matter what your struggle is, God is right here with you. It doesn't matter what your circumstance is this morning, God loves you and He cares for you. There's a song that we used to sing, and that's how you know you're getting seasoned when you start making that statement. There's a song that we used to sing that no matter what happens, He will care for me. He will care for me. He will care for me. And in His mighty hand, He'll enable me to stand no matter what happens to me. But David is in the midst, in the throes of a psychological, of an emotional situation. And he says, Lord, I'm struggling. And the question that he asks is the same question that you and I have had to ask. Lord, how long will I struggle? Here it is. David says, I'm struggling with anguish in my soul. And many of us come to camp meeting with anguish in our soul. Many of us come to camp meeting this far, this far from walking away from the Lord because of all of the challenges that it seems that we have to face incessantly, insistently. And they are problems, they are challenges, they are struggles that seem like they won't go away. There are a lot of young adults this morning who are just, they're right there, they're teetering on the edge of faith or faithlessness because of all of the struggle. And the question they ask is a very real question. How long? Do I have to deal with stuff that nobody can see? Anguish in my soul. I was just watching a documentary about a successful businessman who, by all intents and purposes, or for all intents and purposes, seemed to really have all of the trappings of success. He had a 401k, was doing well, investments, home paid for, paid off. And yet they found him in his living room after having taken a 45 caliber gun and placed it to his head, and he pulled the trigger. And it was a great mystery. It was a great, it caused a lot of commotion. It caused a lot of questions to be raised because on the outside, he looked like he had it going on. He looked like everything was all right, but there was anguish in his soul. It's the stuff that people can't see. Camp meeting is a great place to be when there's stuff happening that no one else can see. Oh, I'm so happy that you're here. God is going to continue to do, because I heard he's been doing it from the time camp meeting commenced. God is going to do some great things in this camp meeting, because he's going to be helping and healing those of us, people like you and me, who look nice on the outside, but come into camp meeting with anguish in our souls, asking the question that all of us have had to ask, that all of us, if we keep living, at some point will ask, Lord, how long? David isn't by himself. Not only did he ask it, not only have you asked it, there's a prophet by the name of Habakkuk. He asked as well. Habakkuk was a prophet who would turn on his television. Okay, maybe he didn't have a television. You know, some of the older saints, they don't do this television. That's okay. And a lot of them were probably right by telling us to get rid of those things. But that's another topic for another time. But Habakkuk, okay, he didn't have a TV, but he pulled out his cell phone. I know he had to have a cell phone. And he would scroll through the news. And he asked the Lord, Lord, how long? Put his cell phone down. He just stepped right out his front door. And there are people marching. There are people protesting. He walked right out of his home, and then there are people who would kill people, go to court, and walk out like Barabbas. The question he asked is not a Republican question, and it's not a Democratic question. It is a question that all of us ask, regardless of our backgrounds, regardless of our affiliations: how long? Here's what I love about Habakkuk. Here's what I love about David. They didn't ask the politician how long. David says, I look to the hills. Where does my help come from? Ah, my help comes from the Lord. And while I believe firmly that everyone should have a civil right, and while I believe that everyone should speak to those issues and those concerns, there's a way that we do it as people of faith. The world needs to see us calling on the name of the Lord. The world needs to see black and white coming together, just like this assembly this morning, calling on the name of the Lord. See, this doesn't make the news. Black and white coming together, worshiping in spirit and in truth, seeking God for help, not only for our social concerns, but for our spiritual concerns, for our physical concerns, for our medical concerns. And until we go back to the Bible, David doesn't ask his neighbor how long. Some of our neighbors are some of the most I'm trying to be the gentle rain. I'm not going to say what I'm going to say. I think that's my nickname. Call me the gentle rain. You guys see me? He doesn't ask his cousin. He calls on the name of the Lord. And camp meeting, I'm so glad everybody is here. I'm so glad to see these great young men up there in the balcony. They're in my seats. That's where I sit during camp meeting. I'm so glad to see these great young men. Because here it is. We've got to call on the name of the Lord. If you want to experience change in your life, call on the name of the Lord. If you want to experience healing in your body, call on the name of the Lord. Aren't you glad David didn't call Dr. Fauci? Because Fauci would have all but killed David. Just go ahead and get an assisted suicide. It's over. But David understood, and you all understand, and the world must know that there is a God who we call on, who sits high and looks low, who is alive. He's just as alive today as he was yesterday, and he'll be just as alive tomorrow as he is today. And we call on his name for our marriages. We call on his name for our singleness. We call on his name for our marriages, for our children. We call on his name for our academic pursuits. We call on his name for our salvation. We call on his name for holiness. We call on his name for healing and for deliverance. It's in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's hope in the name of Jesus. There's strength in the name of Jesus. You can breathe in the name of Jesus. You will have the victory if you call on his name. David says, turn and answer me, O Lord. Here it is. Restore the sparkle to my eyes, or I will die. Camp meeting is a great place to come if you are in need of restoration. Oh, there's no better place to be this week than and if you're watching online, keep watching
all throughout the rest of this week. If you are in need of restoration, what does restoration mean? It means to be brought back to life again. Oh, I don't know about you, but when I watch the news, when I deal with folk on my job, when I deal with the challenges in my community, I come to camp meeting in need of restoration this morning. I need the Lord to revive me. Hallelujah. Thine the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thine the glory. Do what? Revive us again. David says, I need restoration. Lord, I need you to bring me back emotionally. I need you to bring me back psychologically. I need you to bring me back spiritually. I'm on the edge. I have choices to make. Do I date the little thug guy? The James Dean guy? Catching some of these generations, who's super attractive on his Harley and his leather. Our young people would say he has all that drip going on. I'm with you. Or do I ask the Lord to provide for me a godly man or a godly woman of integrity? Some of us are here and you are, while I'm preaching, you are checking your phone to see how much money you have in your checking account because you're going to that attorney and you're going to file that divorce. And your marriage needs restoration. Some of you are looking at your finances and you're going to file that bankruptcy. But because your finances are what? Dead, and they need to be what? Brought back to life again. And then some of us are just right there on the edge of slipping into pagan idolatry because it just seems like this life of faith has been so cruel to me. God, where are you? How long will I have to go through this? And listen, you need your faith restored this morning. How long, Lord? I need you to turn around, see me. See my concern, see my need. I'm standing in the need of prayer. Restore the sparkle to my eyes. The King James Version says restore the light. I believe they use that word, the light. And you remember what David said. The word of the Lord is what? A lamp unto my feet and a light. What David is saying, he's saying, Lord, I need the light of your word to penetrate my heart again, or else I'm going to die. This is our daily bread, saints. This is what we live on. This is what we feed on. We're going to eat some great food, but if we don't eat from this word, I'm telling you, there is health, there is strength, there is sustenance in the word of God. And David says, Lord, unless you restore the light of your word back to my life, I'm going to die. Many of us have come to camp meeting, look, in search of a what? A word from the Lord. And you're going to get one this week. You're going to get a lot this week. And the word of the Lord, what happens is the light that emanates from the word of God will then begin to penetrate your eyes and you'll be able to see how to walk right. Your path will be directed down the right path again because the light that comes from God's word will penetrate your heart, mind, and soul and restore you, rejuvenate you, revive you, and you'll leave camp meeting better for having been here. David says, restore me. Restore the light to my eyes. Here it is. Don't let my enemies gloat, saying we have defeated him. And don't let them rejoice at my downfall. David says this, God, he's challenging the Lord here in that verse. Now, I'm not suggesting y'all run out and challenge God. Here it is. He's saying this. He's saying, if you are who you say you are, you will help me. Here it is. Because the world is looking at what I'm going through. They've heard my testimony. And they need, if you allow me to go down, Lord, you're going to look pretty bad. Somebody's here this morning saying, God, listen, I came to camp meeting for no other reason than for you to look good. Because I'm going through some things, I'm going through some challenges, I'm going through some struggles. Some are perhaps here that may even have some addictions. I'm addicted to this, or I'm addicted to that, or addiction's a strong word. I have a strong liking for this, that, or the other, be it alcohol, drugs, pornography, whatever it is. And you're here and you're saying, Lord, if you don't help me, the world is going to look and watch what happens to me. And they're going to say, if the Lord let that happen to him, why would we serve that kind of God? And so David says, Lord, help me. Because if I go down, my enemies are going to gloat and they're going to mock you. We came to camp meeting for God to do a work in our life. Man, I'm so excited. I'm fired up. I am not a gentle rain today. I'm sorry. I am so fired up. I'm so excited because somebody's going to get the victory over Satan this camp meeting. Somebody is going to make the devil look bad this camp meeting. Somebody is going to, God is going to show himself strong in so many people's lives in this camp meeting. And the enemy's just going to have to stand off to the side and say, well, I'm defeated again. David says, Lord, do a work in my life. Because if you let me fall, if you let me fail, if you let me drop out of school, if you allow drugs or alcohol or pornography, if you allow a mean spirit or a bad attitude to prevail and get the victory in my life, Satan's going to win and the enemy's going to mock you. So show yourself strong for me. Here it is. I'm wrapping it up. Something happens in David's experience. And I want to encourage you this morning, if you stay with God long enough, something's going to happen in your life. Yes, you may be walking through the valley of the shadow of death, but did you hear what I said? You're walking what? Through it. It is not, yea, though I stay in the valley of the shadow of death. It is, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I'm walking through depression. I'm walking through anger management problems. I'm walking through addiction this morning. I'm going to walk through temptation this morning. How am I going to get through it? I'm going to get through it because I'm going to keep my hand in his hand. The light from his word is going to soak and saturate my heart, my mind, and my soul. And where it is dark, God is going to manifest light, and I'm going to walk through it. Here it is. When you are saved, you want to write this down. You want to write this down. When you are saved, you do not have to look for a light at the end of the tunnel. You will have light in the tunnel. Oh, that's clappable. You do not have to wait for a light at the end of the tunnel. That's what they do in the world. That's what sinners do. That's what those who don't know the Lord do. They hope and they wait. I think that's light at the end of the tunnel. And if they don't get saved, they're going to realize that that light's just an oncoming train. But when you keep steady and stay with God, just as we're about to read about a shift in David's life, there's going to be a shift in your situation this morning. You came to camp meeting looking for something, asking how long. Guess what? God's going to answer. Something happens in David's experience. Here it is, verse 5. All of a sudden, David makes a pivot. He makes this U-turn. He says, but I trust in your, King James Version, mercy. New Living Translation, your unfailing love. David, something quickened inside of David where he says, you know what? Wait a minute. I know that I'm having some challenges in my life. I know that I'm going through some experiences that are unfair. I know that when I turn on my television or I just draw back my curtain, I see things in the society that it just seems like it's all out of control. But wait a minute. I'm going to trust in your unfailing love. Listen, the Lord loves you this morning. Jesus loves the little and the big children of the world.
red, yellow, black, and white, we're all precious in His sight. And no matter what you face this morning, no matter the question you came to camp meeting with, I want to remind you this morning that the Lord loves you. David, I think here's what happened. Here's what I think happened. And I think all of us should model David. David remembered. He thought back on all the times the Lord had made a way out of no way. Oh, come on, saints. I need you to think about that all this week. Think about all of the doors that the Lord opened for you that man said could not be opened for you. Think about all the doors God shut for you, that in your flesh or that with your weakness or with your struggle, you wanted to keep open. But His unfailing love for you, He shut some doors for you. Think about how good God has been down through the years. All of the times He's healed your body. All of the times when you were a nervous wreck, He stilled and calmed your spirit. And you were able to get through the storm that you were able to get through. Think about when He mended muscle to metal. Well, I'm using that testimony. Think about when they said it was stage one, stage two, stage three, stage four. And here you are this morning. Somebody said, I lost a lot of weight, but I'm singing for the Lord today. That's the unfailing mercy. That's the unfailing love of God. And when you think about that, it will cause you to want to keep running. It'll cause you to want to keep praying. It'll cause you to want to keep toiling on, because there soon will dawn a brighter day. If I keep praying, if I keep toiling, if I keep thinking over how the Lord has shown His unfailing love in my life, here it is. He says, I will rejoice because you have rescued me. Oh, He will rescue you this morning. Do I have any witnesses this morning that the Lord will rescue you? He'll lift you up out of miry clay. He'll place your feet on solid rock to stay. Oh, the Lord will rescue you this morning. I don't care how far you've gotten out there in sin. If you're not saved this morning, the Lord's unfailing love says, come back to me. Come on back home. Parents, don't be discouraged. They're coming back. Youth workers, don't be discouraged. They're coming back. Oh, the love of the Lord, His unfailing mercy, He will rescue those who call on His name. He'll rescue those that don't call on His name. Some of us are saved and don't know how we got saved. Other than it was the unfailing love of the Lord and an experience like camp meeting. Oh, you're blessed if you're here this morning. You're blessed if you're here. You're blessed if you're watching. David's here it is. He finishes chapter 13 with this. And I close with this. David says, you know what? And I think about what Brother Sherm said earlier, a few moments ago. David says, you know what? Tell you what. While I'm going through my challenge, because look at the text. It doesn't suggest that anything changed about his situation. He changed. Oh, man. Saints, saints, saints. Don't necessarily ask the Lord to change your situation all the time. Ask the Lord to change you. We don't read where things changed in his situation, but we do read where he changed. And he said, while I go through my go-through, while I endure the challenges and the struggles and the vicissitudes of life, he said, I'm going to sing a song. Oh, there is no... So listen, listen, listen. You came to camp meeting asking a question. Lord, how long? Lord, why? Lord, when? And you're going to get great preaching. But I want someone to say, Lord, give me a song in camp meeting. That when camp meeting is over, that song, I'm going to keep singing. There is nothing like praise and worship. It is the perfect complement to the Word of God and to the development of a dynamic spiritual life. I'm not saying be, you know, charismatic. You don't have to swing. Please don't swing from the chandeliers here. I don't quite think they have they got good insurance here, but I don't know if it's that good.
I'm not suggesting that you have to run up and down the aisles or put on this great demonstrative display, but just ask the Lord, Lord, I'm coming to camp meeting for great messages and great word, but I'm also, Lord, give me a song. Put a song in my heart. Give me a song to sing. Oh, church of God, I love thy courts. Thou mother of the free, the blessed home of all the saved, I dwell content in thee. Great song. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer. I don't know the rest. Don't expect me to say it. But you know it. Lord, put a song in my heart so that while I'm going through the challenges that I'm going through, I'll think about how good you've been and I'll make it through the challenges that I'm going with. Who's here this morning who says, Lord, I came to camp meeting asking how long? David says in verse 6, I'll sing to the Lord, here it is, because he is good to me. Listen, you want to write this down. On my worst day, God is still great. I don't care what you are facing. I don't care what the culture, what the society, what people say about you or think about you. I don't care what happens in this world. For God I'll live, for God I'll die. Here it is, because God's been good to me. I'm not concerned about politics or politics. Listen, I want to get to heaven. There's no black heaven. There's no white heaven. There's no Republican heaven. There's no Democrat heaven. There's just heaven. Somebody said this recently. I love this, Pastor Tony. It's not a skin thing. It's a sin thing. Lord, where do I measure up in you? You've been good to me. Who's here this morning who will recognize and be willing to say, God, you've been good to me. I'm going through some challenges and I want to come and pray. I want to come and I don't necessarily need an elder or anyone to pray with me, or you might select someone or ask someone to come and pray with you. But I'm here in prayer and camp meeting and I want to pray. God's been so good to me. I almost gave up, but I came to camp meeting and Lord, I need you to help me. Who's here this morning? Who'll be willing to step out in faith? They have everything clearly marked and delineated. You don't have to worry. There's social distancing. But that's our problem, I think, in the church and in the world. We've got it mixed up. We've been spiritually distancing and doing a whole lot of socializing. We need to draw near to God in camp meeting and socially distance from the things and the challenges and the issues and the pain that have been weighing us down. Who's here who said, all right, I'm coming to camp meeting. I'm going to come and pray, Pastor T. Not necessarily for me, but I'm going to come and intercede for someone else. Who's here this morning that'll say, I want to come and pray. God's been good to me. I came with the question. I've been asking how long. But I'm going to hold on to faith. I'm going to trust in the unfailing love and mercy of God. And I want to come pray. Ask the Lord to revive me, restore me. Is there one? Is there one? I don't know if the musicians are going to come. We don't need a musician. They didn't have them in the Old or New Testament during the service, during the altar call. Forget about the music. Just come. Who's here? Who's here? The altar's open. I want to come. I want to be a better young person. I want to be a better husband. I want to be a better wife. I want to be a better teenager. I want to be a better coworker. I want to be a better saint. And I don't want the enemy to get the victory over my life. Push me, cause me to feel as though God is not present. I want to extend the invitation one last time, then I'll sit down. Anyone here who says, I just want to be a better believer this year? Can't be. Glad I'm here. Bless you.
Time to pray.
The last verse of that 13th Psalm said, I will sing unto the Lord because he hath dealt bountifully. He didn't just help me. He didn't just save me. He didn't just deliver me. He filled my cup and it kept overflowing. There are others. God bless you. Will Brenda play softly? The religious bureaucracy of Jesus' day, they missed the opportunity of lifetime because they could not discern the time of Jesus' visitation, God's visitation. There's nothing anybody can add to what we just heard this morning. All you had to do is just feel the presence of God. How God was speaking to every heart in this building, those listening via live stream. There's a lot of problems, a lot of heartaches. And I'll just say this, and I'm through. Maybe when you came here, you're struggling, but you're not really under the weight of it. But somebody you know and somebody that you love, they're struggling. And they're about to crumble underneath the weight of all that's going on in their life. Perhaps you can feel the weight of that struggle and come down here and stand in the gap for that person, that one you love, that one you know, and you can intercede for them. You see, it's not always about you. It's about that son, that daughter, that neighbor. Some have come. Why don't you come? Father, thank you for this service. We just feel there are others that need to respond to the gentleness of your Holy Spirit. Lord, you know who they are, where they are. You know what their issues are all about. And Lord, only you can open up the heart. Only you can open up a mind. And so we ask that as the pianist plays softly, just for another moment, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, someone needs a nudge. Oh Lord, we pray, be it young or old or in between. Thank you for passing by this morning. In Jesus' name.
My wife brought the scripture up on her telephone and she showed it to me. You know what it said at the very top of this psalm? It said, for the choir director. That's exactly what it says on her telephone with this scripture. I appreciate that. Because I can't get any point more pointed than that. But I was reminded this morning, I've had this little piece of paper hanging on my dash on my old truck out here. And I went out and got it. Didn't know when I was going to read it or what. I wrote this stuff down, I don't know, months ago, and stuck it on my dash. And I wrote, "Preach to our preachers. Speak to our speakers. Direct our directors. And lead our leaders. And help us all to love like Jesus did." It meant so much, I just stuck it there. And I just read it to you.
Heart satisfied? All right. Pray for Brother Webb. He'll be bringing the Word of God tonight. Just seemed like the camp meeting is getting better and better and better. About the time you hear a fabulous sermon, you say, "Man, that was the best of the camp meeting." Then along some comes the next fella or woman. And it just keeps getting better and better. "And I will sing unto the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with us." Just keeps getting better. And we are the only people who can say, we're living the dream. God bless you.